A verdant oasis and nestled within it flats, public and private, with smart features, elderly-friendly, family-focused, well interconnected with clean air and minimal vehicular traffic. A city-state comprised of other self-contained mini-cities, each a distinctive regional hub with their own commercial, business, social and educational facilities. A vision for a future Singapore, one that we can all be proud of. This is not a pipe dream. This is work in progress. We already see signs of it in Punggol and Sengkang, also in the future developments for the Jurong Lake District, Bidadari and Tengah. As we journey towards that vision, it's perhaps helpful for us to look back, look inwards, and also look forward. In looking back, it is important to remind ourselves that home ownership has been and continues to be a key component of our national policy and a key pillar of our social compact with Singaporeans. We have gone from third world to first, as one of the key movers of social mobility has been our provision of affordable, quality, public housing for the vast majority of Singaporeans. Our housing policy is one that is much lauded internationally, one that has allowed generations of Singaporeans to move up the social ladder. Compared to many other countries like the UK, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and even Australia, just to name a few, the young there find it difficult to rent a place, not to say afford to buy their own homes. All this reminds us of the purpose of development in our country, to provide better lives for our people. This brings us to the opportunity to also look inwards at a housing policy that seeks to be both practical and efficient, and also one that is compassionate. We have much to be grateful for. Flats for different people, different life stages, different incomes. Buy a home with your parents or stay near your parents, you get a grant. First-time applicants get a grant when buying a brand new or resale flat. Rental flats have also been made available to young married couples waiting for their new flats to be ready. Flats for the elderly, to allow seniors to monetize their flats. These are but some of the schemes that have promulgated social equity in Singapore. It is something that we should be rightly proud of. I'm also glad that the Fresh Start housing scheme, which allows families living in rental flats to be able to buy their own homes, has taken off well. At the same time, I feel for those who continue to live in rental flats. I refer to an opinion piece in the Straits Times, dated 16th of February this year, and it's titled, HDB Should Apply Its Own Occupancy Rules to Rental Housing. The writers of the article highlighted the fact that though the occupancy cap for the number of tenants allowed in larger flats have been brought down to 6, the cap for 1- and 2-room flats remains at 4. They argue that this cap should also apply to those living in HDB's 1- to 2-room rental flats. In their survey, they claim that 15% of those living in rental flats had more than 4 household members. They also state that overcrowding affects the well-being of children, family relationships, and health. I have seen this firsthand, and I'm sure many of us in this house have residents like that too. I fully accept the Ministry's stand that rental flats are but an interim measure for families and they should be encouraged to move on to their own purchase flats. It would do wonders for the families living in these flats, particularly for their self-esteem and family relationships, if more can be done for them. So what more can the Ministry do in tandem with perhaps other ministries to do more for such residents and to give them that boost up in social mobility? There are also our elders who are living in rental flats, those without kin, those who are single. Their silver years can be difficult too. Often they end up sharing a small flat with a complete stranger, with no privacy whatsoever. Some even endure abuse from their flatmates, living uncomfortably in silence because they are afraid of having no other place to stay. Just yesterday morning, the MND Facebook page also posted a link of an article on co-living. It's perhaps telling that the quote extracted for the post was this, and I quote, "As it turns out, people don't really want to share bathrooms or bedrooms for that matter, but are fine perhaps with sharing kitchens, workspaces, gardens and the internet." So how does the Ministry therefore respond to the changing needs even within our rental populations, in this case for our lower income families and especially for our elders? Another group of singles that the Ministry has made great progress on is our younger singles. The newly enhanced proximity housing grant also includes a higher grant of $15,000 for singles staying near their parents, and a grant of $15,000 for those staying with their parents, and $10,000 for those staying near their parents. Since 2013, the Single Singaporean Citizen Scheme has also been enhanced to allow for direct purchase from HDB. However, while we continue to advocate strongly for more marriages and also strengthen parenthood benefits, society is evolving quickly. I've come across many single Singaporeans who face challenges in securing their flats because we have fixed the age base as 35 years of age. Younger Singaporeans are becoming financially independent earlier and are marrying later. How then can the Ministry reiterate the reasons for setting the bar at 35 years of age? Or will the Ministry consider reviewing this in the future? A separate group of singles also deserves our attention and a compassionate hand in addressing their difficulties, and these are our divorced parents. Today, our policies perhaps are seen as compounding the difficulties of those already undergoing divorce, especially those who have custody of their children. While HDB frontline staff do their best, it is perhaps time for us to take a better and closer look at how we respond to complex cases. To give an example, one of my residents saw me almost a year and a half ago. Hers was a complex case. She had full custody of her two children, but only for a limited time, and then joint custody after that. She and her children were left without a place to stay, moving from friend to friend or renting short-term from the open market. I empathised with her and we worked on multiple solutions, yet each time that we tried, we were faced with a brick wall. Replies were factual, but offering no real solace for a mother desperate to provide a better environment for her two young children and a safe haven for herself. In Chinese, we have a saying, 清官难判家务事. Even the most upright of judges will find it hard to settle family disputes. But try we must, and I think we can do better. Can the Ministry consider better case management of complex cases like these, if only for the children? I'm happy to report for this particular case that the mother and her two children now have a flat to call their own. As we strive for a compassionate system, it's also timely for us to look forward. One of the topics that occupied the space last year was the issue of diminishing leases. Along with those reducing leases means that many of our flats, buildings and estates as a whole are getting older. Therefore, there is definitely a need for upgrading, renewal and rejuvenation. Today, we have the Neighbourhood Renewal Programme and the Home Improvement Programme for our residential estates and the Remaking Our Heartlands Programme for neighbourhood centres. As more flats come of age, what else is the Ministry looking at to rejuvenate and refresh our estates? While the future excites us, we need the past to also remind us of where we've come from. So, amidst a future skyline, we need signs of our past to be preserved as our built heritage. I spoke about this over the last 2 years of the budget and hope that we can continue to do more. Singapore's first tallest residential condominium, the Pearl Bank Apartments, will be meeting with the Wreckers Ball very soon. Sold recently for $728 million, the apartments will unfortunately not be conserved. However, it is good to note that the developers have heeded the calls of heritage lovers and agreed to consider blending heritage elements into the new development. What we can control, we do, but there are also clouds on the future horizon. According to the Climate Action Plan of 2016, sea levels are expected to rise. And with 30% of Singapore just 5 meters above sea level, what does this mean for our built infrastructure? How are we preparing for it? Part of this has been answered by the earlier COS on the environment. To achieve our vision of a future city and home for all Singaporeans, we need the right professionals and know how to achieve this. How else will the Ministry also grow the pool of local talents that we have in the fields of engineering, design, architecture, and technology? Mr. Chairman, I beg to move.